Kingsbridge HealthStyle, the health and wellbeing podcast brought to you by Kingsbridge Healthcare Group. My name is Avril Keys and I'm hosting this series of podcasts where I put real patient questions to the medical team at the hospital. From diagnostics through to treatment, we'll give you the lowdown on what to watch out for and when you should make an appointment. And if you have a question for us to use on a future podcast, you can contact us via the email in the information section below. So today's guest on the podcast is Dr. Patrick Campbell, a consultant gynecologist and, hope I get this right because I fell over the words on Instagram, a urogynaecologist. Only consultant in Northern Ireland who can offer vaginal surgery, keyhole surgery and non-surgical radiofrequency treatments to improve prolapse, urinary incontinence, vaginal laxity and sexual function after childbirth. Welcome, Dr. Campbell. Ahead of all of these podcasts, I seek questions from the women who follow me in terms of the topics that I'm covering. And I think out of all of the topics that I've covered, this has been the one where the questions that I've come in have really actually been a bit upsetting in places, because there are a lot of women out there who are suffering in silence, who probably just don't know the treatments that are available to them. So looking forward to covering some of these topics. And I suppose the good one to start with is incontinence. And it's a very broad topic. Maybe you could just fill me in on the different types of incontinence and then the kinds of treatment that you can offer.
Sure, no problem. Well, thanks very much for having me.
Okay.
So incontinence is a very common condition that can affect up to one in three women. And there's various different types of incontinence. It can impact on people's lives in different ways. Some people have incontinence and it doesn't bother them. Some people have incontinence and it can destroy their lives. So there's a huge spectrum of impact, really, on quality of life. In terms of the different types, there's stress incontinence, which is when you leak, if you laugh, cough or sneeze, jump, move, exercise. And then there's urge incontinence, where you get that horrible feeling of urgency of needing to get to the bathroom. And then if you don't get there in time, you leak. And okay. So there's different types, and some women have both, a mix of both stress and urge incontinence.
Okay.
So if you took, say, 100 women off, you know, that have incontinence, about half of them would have pure stress incontinence, about a third of them would have a mix of stress and urge incontinence, and about 10% or so would have purely urge incontinence.
And is it a particular age group, and is it related to anything like childbirth, or can it just be something that some people have?
Yeah, so I see women of all ages, from sort of usually sort of early 20s right through to women in their 80s, really. So it's a broad spectrum of conditions, you know.
And not just childbirth related then?
Exactly. Yeah. So childbirth can cause damage, which can result in incontinence. Yeah. But similarly, as you get older and you go through the menopause, falling hormone levels can lead to further weakening. So some women develop incontinence around the menopause,
yes,
or sometimes later in life.
You've brought a prop with you. I think it's probably a good chance for you to tell me more about this.
So one type of incontinence that I see a lot of is exercise-related incontinence. So sometimes a woman may have had a couple of children and take up exercise, mm-hmm, and then suddenly they experience leakage. They go to the gym and they've never had incontinence before. So sometimes exercise can put a lot more strain on your pelvic floor than maybe you're used to in your day-to-day activities. So some women that just have exercise-related incontinence maybe don't want to necessarily go down the route of surgery, because mm-hmm, they may see that as quite a big intervention. So the first protocol would usually be to see a women's health physiotherapist to complete a course of pelvic floor muscle training. But sometimes they need a bit more, and that's where something like this can come in. So this is called the Uresta device. And it's like a little tampon, and that goes in, you insert that into the vagina before exercise, okay, and then take it out afterwards, so it's a temporary device. And that can be any exercise, you know, it could be simply going to the gym, it could be going out for a run,
yeah,
or it could be someone in their 70s or 80s who plays golf once a week,
okay,
or someone who goes dancing, or, you know, so it's not always just the high level athletes, it's,
yes,
any kind of physical activity, and it's a temporary device. So it's something that I've had a great success with a lot of my patients, and we're actually doing a clinical study in the Maypole Clinic at the moment, where we've recruited 50 women who experience incontinence with exercise,
mm-hmm,
and we followed them up over the last year. So
yeah,
we've had women who go to do, you know, gym classes, some that do 5K, some 10K, triathletes, mm-hmm, marathon runners, and we have a few ultra marathon runners as well, so a whole broad spectrum.
Okay.
And they've been using this for the years.
So, and it's nice they can sort of self-manage the condition then.
Exactly,
and
right, yeah, exactly, yeah. Yeah.
And I suppose that brings me on to treatment. So you talked about, obviously, physio would be the first line of treatment in the case of incontinence. Are there other treatments available beyond that then that women can explore?
Exactly, yeah. So if we take stress incontinence, first of all, so physiotherapy, then sometimes trialing devices can mm-hmm. be helpful. We have a treatment in Maypole Clinic called Vivive, which uses radio frequency energy to boost collagen in the vagina. That can also be helpful for more milder degrees of incontinence. And then after that, then you're moving on to surgery.
Okay.
And there's a few different options. You can inject their little fillers into the urethra, same way people get fillers in their lips or their cheeks.
Yeah.
You can inject little fillers into the urethra, which can be helpful, or you can move on to more major surgery. And there's an operation I do called the fascial sling, where you take a strip of your own body tissue, where you would have a cesarean section scar, for example, just in that area.
Okay.
And we remove a little strip of tissue and make a sling that goes underneath the urethra.
Wow.
It's a bit similar to the mesh sling that was used. The mesh sling has been suspended now for several years.
Okay.
So the fascial sling I do now instead.
Right,
so what's important, I suppose, when someone has incontinence, it's about really kind of exploring what their goals are.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's no right or wrong thing to do. It's about connecting with the patient and understanding where they want to be. So some people don't want to have major surgery and they're maybe happy just being a little bit better.
Yes.
Whereas some people come and say, I want to be dry.
Yes.
And then they maybe go for the bigger surgery. So it's about kind of making sure that you're on the same page with where they want to be.
And the likes of that sort of filler treatment, that would that have to be repeated?
Yeah, it's not exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's not a long lasting treatment. So yeah, that's a really good point. So if I had someone who came to me with stress incontinence, they tried physiotherapy, they'd maybe tried a device, and they're using, you know, 3 or 4 pads a day, and they're avoiding exercise, and you talk to them and you say, well, where do you want to be with this? And they say, I want to be dry.
Yeah.
Well, then I would sort of counsel them about the different options.
Yes.
And most of those women would go for more major surgery.
Okay.
In the past, in terms of success rates for surgery, so people often, I think you'd asked me beforehand,
yes,
like, what are the successes of surgery? And it's a really interesting point, because in the past, that's what people used often to make their decisions about surgery. Whereas now, there's definitely a shift, and people will make their decision based on risk profile of different treatments. And I think that's probably come around since the mesh issues.
Yes.
So they'll say, well, here's this operation. Well, what are the possibilities? What could go wrong? What are the risks? And they'll often base their decision based on that. So that's why things like the urethral lithotripsy or the Vivive radio frequency, those sorts of treatments that are very low risk.
Yeah.
The trade-off between success and risk is often something that women
use
to make their decision.
But it's nice to have some other less invasive ways of treating it to see if that
exactly
actually ticks the boxes for you.
So that would be stress incontinence. In terms of urge incontinence, so that would, lifestyle measures, weight loss, reduction in caffeine intake, trying to retrain the bladder, pelvic floor exercises, all of those things can all be done in primary care, with GP and continence nurses, physiotherapists in the community.
Okay.
So a lot of those lifestyle measures, it's important to address all of those first of all.
Okay.
If a woman's still having problems with overactive bladders, so that could be running to the toilet a lot during the day, urgency, and urge incontinence, and also up at night. So a lot of those women will be up maybe 3-4 times at night to pass urine. So that's overactive bladder. If that doesn't get better with the conservative lifestyle measures, tablets can be tried, and there's various different tablets, and they can all be prescribed by GPs.
Okay.
If those don't work, then that's when you come on to more invasive treatments like the Botox bladder injections.
Yes, so you're going to have to explain this more, because we're back to another facial treatment or aesthetic treatment.
I do Botox and fillers, yeah.
Just not where most people do. So how does bladder Botox work?
So it's a fascinating treatment, okay? It started 2005. A Swiss urologist started using it in patients with spinal cord injuries and that had bladder problems.
Yes.
And that's where it began. So I look after women that have overactive bladder, also maybe due to neurological problems. So I see a lot of women with multiple sclerosis and those sorts of conditions where they have a neurological problem that affects the bladder. So they started using Botox in those patients, and there was dramatic improvement. And then over the years, then it gradually then started to be used in women that had overactive bladder but didn't have neurological problems.
Okay.
In terms of how it works, that's a good question.
Okay.
I spent 2 years in Queens doing research in this area because it's so fascinating in terms of how it works, and it's a slightly different mechanism to where you would normally relate it to. So when you inject it into the face for wrinkles, that's acting on what's called skeletal muscle. So skeletal muscle is muscle that you can control yourself.
Okay.
The bladder is composed of smooth muscle, which we don't have active control over. So it in some way affects muscle function, but it also in the bladder affects sensory function.
Okay.
So whenever you are sitting drinking a cup of tea or a glass of water and your bladder starting to fill, as your bladder starts to stretch, that sends a message to your brain to say your bladder's full.
Mm-hmm.
So a lot of women with overactive bladder have very sensitive bladders. So with a smaller amount of urine in the bladder, it's firing off that message to say you need to find a bathroom.
Yeah.
So in some way, Botox down-regulates that sensory system as well. So it works in different ways. So we don't fully understand it, but it doesn't work purely as a paralysis, because most of the women that have it done can still pass urine.
Yes, I think that's what you would think when you hear
so
the word
we say
Botox.
It paralyzes your bladder, but it doesn't really. It also affects sensory bladder function.
And again, it would be something you'd have to have topped up, I presume, after.
Yeah, so typically lasts between 6 and 9 months.
All right, that's quite.
And you know, and it means that they don't have to take tablets, and they basically just come up once a year or twice a year for an office-based treatment. So it's basically pop up on the couch, a little camera into the bladder, inject the Botox, and off you go. So I have a video on my Instagram of the procedure just to show how straightforward
it is.
We'll
add your handle below as well so people can find you easily.
Yeah.
I mean, are there risks to it?
So everything, there's risks associated. The two main risks with Botox injection to the bladder is urinary tract infection and what we call voiding dysfunction, or difficulty passing urine.
Okay.
So around 15% of women have difficulty emptying their bladder afterwards. So maybe 2 days later, they go to the bathroom and nothing comes out.
Okay.
So they have to use a little small catheter to empty the bladder. I should have brought one as a prop, actually, because when you say a catheter, people think the catheter you would have when you're in hospital, but these catheters they're very short, they're about this length, and they're very discreet. So every woman that's having that treatment would need to learn to self-catheterize beforehand.
Okay.
If that does happen, it may only last for a few days, it might last for a few weeks, but in some cases it can last for several months.
Okay.
So all the women have to be equipped with the skills to self-manage.
So you
them.
Can't reverse the effect of the Botox on the bladder?
No, but it wears off.
It wears off, yeah. Because there were a number of questions around that. And in terms of, someone asked specifically about allergy testing for the Botox. Is that something that...
No issue. Another question that I often get asked is, you know, does it become less effective with
the
time?
The more you have it, okay.
So I gave Botox to a lady this week who's been having it for 10 years.
Right, okay.
And she was previously using 5 or 6 pads a day.
Right. And so she getting the same length of time with each treatment?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it makes her completely dry, and she gets about 9 months out of it.
Amazing.
And then comes back, so...
Yeah. Okay, that's fantastic.
Yeah, yeah,
very
yeah.
good to hear. There was lots and lots of questions about prolapse, and I suppose there was talk of vaginal prolapse, bladder prolapse. I had to Google some things, and I think I would really love you to just explain what's meant by the term prolapse, what organs does it involve, and why would it happen?
Yeah, okay. So I suppose the pelvic organs are supported by muscles and tissues that hold everything in place. And if those structures and support mechanisms become weakened, then the pelvic organs can slip downwards.
Okay.
So the bladder, the uterus, and the bowel can all slip downwards into the vagina, and that's often felt as a bulge or a lump or a heaviness or discomfort in the vagina, sometimes a blockage inserting tampons or during intercourse.
Mm-hmm.
So that's essentially what a prolapse is. So it's a downward displacement, a slippage of the organs downwards into the vagina.
So whether it's bladder or people talk about vaginal prolapse, it is kind of all the one thing?
Yeah, so we would term pelvic organ prolapse would be sort of the medical term, and that would be the all-encompassing term for all of the different types of prolapse. And childbirth can damage and weaken the support structures, and aging can also affect it in terms of lowering of hormone levels. But there's also lifestyle issues such as obesity, chronic straining, so people that have chronic constipation or chest problems where they're chronically coughing, or activities where they're lifting very heavy things, those sorts of things can contribute to it also.
Okay, and how would you know, you know, what would make you know that you had had some sort of prolapse?
Yeah, so that again, that's a really good question. So you, in terms of the symptoms, someone might describe a feeling of a bulge, a lump, something coming down, discomfort, heaviness within the vagina, sometimes like they're sitting on an egg or sitting on a tennis ball, or the blockage type symptoms. But also sometimes women have prolapse but don't experience any of those symptoms.
Yes.
And quite often a woman may go to the GP surgery for a smear test, for example, and have a smear test done, and they're told, oh, you have a prolapse. And that often creates a lot of anxiety, and there'll be people listening to this where that will have happened. And if the prolapse isn't bothering you, so if you've got no symptoms from it, then you don't need to do anything.
I was asked that specifically, yes.
Maybe it's wrong of me to say you don't need to do anything. What you probably need to do is have a look at your lifestyle and maybe make some adjustments based on that. So, for example, if you've been told you have a prolapse and you're overweight or obese, then weight loss would be a good idea. And pelvic floor exercises, if you're not already doing them, would be a good idea also. And then if you've got chronic constipation or cough, trying to address those sort of issues.
Okay.
So to try and reduce your chance of maybe it becoming an issue further down the line.
Yes, but there's no need to panic about it.
No.
Can it be connected to the incontinence then, having this prolapse? Are the two connected?
Yeah, sometimes they are. Whenever a woman has incontinence and a prolapse, sometimes that can be quite complex to deal with. Mm-hmm. What we always go back to is, what are the symptoms? You know, so if someone has a prolapse and they're not bothered by the prolapse, but they've got incontinence, then we would focus on trying to treat the symptoms.
Yes. Are there any other symptoms that you might notice that would indicate that there could be a prolapse?
Yeah, so in terms of symptoms, we can talk about vaginal symptoms, bladder, bowel and sexual dysfunction. So prolapse can affect all of those. So if you had a prolapse, it may affect how you empty your bladder. So you may have difficulty passing urine, or similarly it may cause incontinence or other bladder issues. In terms of a prolapse of the back wall of the vagina, that can impact quite significantly on bowel function. And what we mean by that is passing a bowel motion, going to the toilet to do a poo. Simple day-to-day activities or functions that we take for granted.
Yes.
Someone with a large prolapse, for example, when they go to the toilet to do a poo, the poo bulges into the prolapse.
Okay.
And they may have difficulty actually getting the poo to come out.
Okay.
And this is often something that women are very embarrassed to talk about. I talk about it every day, so I'm quite comfortable talking about it.
Yeah.
But women will very rarely volunteer that. So they'd be sitting in the consultation and you might ask, do you have any difficulty passing a bowel motion? And they go, yeah, I do. You know, I have to do all sorts of manoeuvres to get the poo to come out. And that can have a huge impact on quality of life.
I suppose to reassure women, because, you know, I guess I would feel, yes, I'd have to get myself to the point where I would be willing to go to a doctor about it, but I might feel a bit nervous about going to a male doctor, a younger doctor, about it. So can you reassure the women listening that you've seen and heard it all and nothing will shock or surprise you?
Yeah. So I suppose I've trained as a gynaecologist, and then I've also spent 2 years doing subspecialty training in what's called urogynaecology, as you mentioned at the start. So that is kind of a higher level of training to deal with more complex pelvic floor issues. So I've spent a lot of time speaking to patients with these, so there's nothing that'll surprise me.
Nothing you haven't heard before, yes.
Yeah.
And I guess on that, what are the kind of red flags then that, you know, as a woman, the things that we might be just keeping to ourselves and sort of pushing to the back of our minds, what are the red flags we should really be thinking about approaching a doctor about?
I think whenever it starts to affect your quality of life. So none of these issues are necessarily life-threatening, but they're hugely life-limiting. You know, and I see women that have completely transformed their lives, their lifestyle, their way of life, their daily activities around their pelvic floor symptoms. So they will often have stopped doing exercise, for example. They may have stopped going out with family or friends. They may be housebound. They may have stopped working. So that's a huge impact. I've had a couple of nurses recently that have had serious issues with incontinence and wearing PPE. During COVID, so you can imagine it takes a lot of time to get gowned up in all your protective gear. Yes. If you have urgency,
of course,
and you've suddenly got gowned up, you can't get to the toilet and mm-hmm. you're incontinent. You're soaking through scrubs and things like that. People that work in call centres, teachers, people work in the legal profession, in court, you know, all of those jobs
where they can't easily
and sometimes we take for granted that if you need to pass your urine, that you can hold on and wait. Mm-hmm. A lot of people can't. So it can impact hugely on quality of life. It can also impact on relationships. Mm-hmm. So a lot of these issues can affect sex life, you know, in terms of vaginal laxity, looseness, incontinence. Some women will leak urine during intercourse. Some women may have pain and discomfort. And that's often quite upsetting for the women and kind of a huge impact on that aspect of their lives.
Yes, so that's something as well that there were questions in that space. So, you know, pain during intercourse, pain putting on a tampon.
Yeah. You know,
so there are all the kinds of things you can treat. And mm-hmm. vaginal laxity post-children, what kinds of treatments are available for these?
So in terms of pain and discomfort, there can be a whole range of causes. Sometimes it can be due to issues with the pelvic floor muscles being too tight or being tender. Sometimes it can be due to the skin around that area and the changes through menopause. Mm. There's also a condition called vulvodynia, where it's the women experience like a burning pain at the vaginal opening. And that again can be treated with medications, and even Botox injection can sometimes be helpful for that too.
Okay.
So those sort of painful issues really require very detailed assessment, because mm-hmm. there can be a whole range of different causes for that. Sometimes there's other sort of deeper causes, like endometriosis as well, where you can have problems inside the pelvis that can cause painful intercourse. So it's a very it's a very difficult area to give general advice on. You kind of need to see the patient to sort of work out what's going on.
Don't suffer
in silence is the key.
There's always some sort of treatment that can be given for it. I think there were lots and lots of questions about UTIs in all of the contexts. A number of women who suffer with multiple UTIs, just one after another, can't ever seem to get relief from it. What causes these, and what are the kinds of treatments that are available?
Okay, so urinary tract infections are very common. Probably half of women will experience at least one urinary tract infection during their lifetime. Recurrent urinary tract infection would be considered if you had three infections or more in a 12-month period. Mm-hmm. There's different reasons why that might be. So it may be that you experience urinary tract infection after intercourse, mm-hmm. Or you may have recently gone through the menopause and be starting to get infections. So there's different times of your life when you're maybe at risk of infections. And I suppose the treatments are quite generic initially, but if you think there's a particular activity or a particular time in your life where maybe that's caused the infections, then that may target your treatment. So for example, if we take the perimenopausal women, early 50s, never had infections before, mm-hmm. and suddenly now experiencing repeated infections, that can often be due to a change in the hormone levels. So before the menopause, there's lots of estrogen, and that makes the skin inside the vagina quite thick and lubricated, and that's mm-hmm. due to high levels of glycogen, essentially sugar, and that's what the lactobacilli, or the friendly bacteria, feed off, and that maintains an acidic pH in the vagina. When you go through the menopause, hormone levels drop, and that leads to a thinning of the skin in the vagina, a fall in those sort of sugar levels. Mm-hmm. There's less food for the friendly bacteria, and then the nasties get in, so the E. coli bacteria and those sorts of bugs that can then cause infections. So E. coli UTIs are very common post-menopause. So antibiotics aren't necessarily the way to treat mm-hmm. that. What you need to do is try and restore the hormone levels within the vagina, restore that natural acidic pH to get the nice lactobacilli back in again. So that can be for that age group. Sometimes younger girls, maybe when they initially become sexually active, start to develop infections, and that can be treated with different types of antibiotic therapy. So general advice, you know, passing urine after intercourse, and those sorts of things are obviously important. But in terms of antibiotics, you can use what's called post-coital antibiotics. So you can take one dose of an antibiotic within 2 hours of having intercourse. Or you can have what's called self-start antibiotics, where you get a course of antibiotic from your GP. And if you feel the symptoms coming on, you can start it.
Okay.
Because what often happens is a woman starts to get symptoms, they phone the GP surgery, they leave a sample in, they get a script, but like days have gone on and then the infection's really taken hold. So self-start antibiotics can be helpful.
Okay.
And then the third type of antibiotic is a low-dose continuous antibiotic, where you take a small dose every night for 3 months.
Okay.
And that can sometimes be effective.
But that would be in the younger population?
Well, any age. Okay. Any age really, yeah.
And so in the case of where it's potentially menopause driven, I mean, would people still come to you, or would you be going towards, we've spoken to Dr. Siobhan Kirk in a different podcast, so would you go to Siobhan or would you go to you?
So I suppose if you go back to the symptoms, so the problem that the woman has is recurrent infections, they'll probably come to me. If they've got night sweats, flushes, other menopause type symptoms,
yes,
then maybe go to Siobhan. But I think that's the benefit of what we have to offer here in Kingsbridge, is that we have a whole range of specialists, and if I saw someone with recurrent urinary tract infections but also had serious issues with other menopause symptoms, I would recommend referral to Siobhan. And similarly, if Siobhan had someone with menopause symptoms but also some pelvic floor dysfunction, she would refer to me.
Too, so all under one roof.
All under one roof, exactly.
But you could prescribe the hormone treatment that they might need to help that.
Yeah, so
I
would prescribe vaginal estrogen treatments. Okay. So if you're going on to sort of oral or transdermal, that's Siobhan's area.
Yeah.
So I tend not to get involved with that.
Yeah.
So if you've got repeated urinary tract infections because of vaginal dryness, then vaginal estrogen is very straightforward. But you don't need to come to me to have that prescribed. Like a GP could prescribe that. You know, it's not a very specialist treatment.
Yeah.
It's just about recognising the problem and being able to treat it effectively.
Yes. And with the UTIs, I have heard there is a vaccine, and I wondered, what is that? And I mean, could that be the kind of the silver bullet that many women would be looking for?
Yeah, I know it's interesting. It's sort of come around the same time as the COVID vaccine.
Yes.
But it works in a very different way. So the way that the UTI vaccine works is on what's called your mucosa-associated lymphoid tissue, or MALT, M-A-L-T. So in the mucosa of your mouth, any kind of surface of the body, there's kind of like the initial defences.
Mm-hmm.
And what the UTI vaccine involves is a little spray under the tongue, which the woman self-administers every day for 3 months. So there's no needles, no injections. And what that does, that builds up your immunity to the four most common bugs that cause urinary tract infections.
Okay. So that could be something useful for some of the women that contact me who, even to get treated for urinary tract infections, causes a urinary tract infection, or they're so repeated that
Can't so most women, it's still an off-license use.
Okay.
So I've started one patient on it
so far,
and she's the first in Ireland.
Okay.
So it's all very new.
Yeah.
There are a few of my colleagues in England are using it, and there have been a few studies that have been published. The UK study that was published recruited about 75 women.
Okay.
And of those, 78% were infection-free for the 12 months following treatment, where previously they'd had at least 3 infections in that 12-month period.
That's encouraging.
And the women that seemed to do best with it were the younger women who were experiencing infections after intercourse, you know, whereas than the women who'd gone through the menopause. They can still have it, but the success rate is probably not as good.
As good, okay.
But it's quite exciting new treatment.
Yeah, and I suppose it's good to hear about the kinds of new treatments that are out there. I mean, are there any treatments that you think maybe women wouldn't know about that can address issues that maybe they are living with in silence and just putting up with?
Yeah, so another treatment is bladder installation therapy. which involves bladder instillation therapy.
Okay.
And that's where we inject almost like a gel into the bladder, and it contains something called glycosaminoglycan, or GAG, G-A-G, and it sort of builds up a protective lining inside the bladder. Okay. And that can be effective for recurrent infections, but also for bladder pain. We haven't even touched them. Bladder pain is a whole other area. So bladder pain is a terrible condition. It can really destroy a woman's life, and often undiagnosed for quite long periods of time. So bladder instillation therapy is another, can be another effective treatment.
So when you say bladder pain, so it's different to the sort of pain you would have with a UTI?
It's often much worse. So women with bladder pain will experience a lot of discomfort with a full bladder, and often relieved after they've passed urine.
Okay.
It's not a very common condition.
Okay.
And often gets treated as UTI.
Okay.
And often they'll come to see me after multiple courses of antibiotics, but still having symptoms.
Okay, that's interesting. And any other kinds of treatments? I'm thinking of the post childbirth, for instance.
Okay.
So, I know from the questions there's a number of women out there who don't feel the same after they've had their baby.
Yeah.
Maybe feel like this laxity issue.
Yeah.
But don't really think that there's anything you can do.
Yes,
about
exactly.
That.
Yeah.
Or maybe have had a traumatic birth.
Mm-hmm.
And have just kind of gone, okay, I'll just pretend that didn't happen.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. So vaginal laxity, childbirth problems are very common.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if you go back to the actual first 6 weeks, 8 weeks after a baby's born and you're recovering, and then you go to see your GP for your 6 week check, and then that's it.
Yeah.
You know, and you're out into the big bad world with your baby and you're living with your new body. And there's an awful lot of changes happen through childbirth, and it can impact in lots of different ways. So we've talked about, you know, impact of, you know, incontinence and prolapse.
Yeah.
But there's also more subtle changes that can happen that often get discounted as not being important.
Mm-hmm.
And with delivering a baby through the pelvic floor stretches everything, stretches the tissue, stretches the muscles, and can leave a woman with a feeling of looseness or laxity in the vagina. Mm-hmm. And that's generally a symptom that's felt during intercourse. So they don't feel the same sensation in that area as they did before. And women are often embarrassed to talk about it. I did a study when I was working in England of about 2,500 women who came to our clinics, and 38% of them reported a feeling of vaginal laxity or looseness. So it's very common.
Yeah.
But we know from other research that 80% of women won't discuss that with their doctor, and often because they're too embarrassed.
Yeah.
And often women will have built up a relationship with their GP over many years, and with those sort of very intimate issues, they may feel embarrassed to raise it because they kind of feel, well, they're just going to say you've had a baby, what do you expect?
Yes.
You know, and so they're often reluctant to come forward. And furthermore, research has shown that up to 50% of doctors don't see it as an issue.
Yes.
So that again is an issue. So women may build up the courage to speak to their GP, but may then be told, actually, this isn't an issue.
It's not important.
So if you come to a doctor, it can be difficult. So in terms of treatment options available, say assessment is key. So to be examined to see what has happened.
Mm-hmm.
If there's a lot of damage and the vagina is very wide and the pelvic floor has been stretched significantly, surgery is required to tighten mm-hmm. the vagina. In terms of the outcomes, the hope is that will regain the feelings that they had before, but not always, because if there's nerve damage done during childbirth, that can affect vaginal sensation. Mm-hmm. So it is quite a complex area.
Yeah.
There are non-surgical treatments. So we use a treatment called Vivive, which uses non-surgical sort of vaginal treatment. So it delivers radiofrequency heat energy into the tissues to boost collagen production.
Right.
And that can also help to improve the sensation of vaginal
laxity.
Is that
the same treatment you talked about from the incontinence?
For the stress incontinence,
then?
Yeah, exactly. Yes, yeah.
Okay.
So we use it for both.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So there is help out there, and
yeah.
You know, so it might be just a case a bit like we talked about menopause in another podcast, and it sounds a lot similar in terms of getting the information, finding out the facts, and then coming to your GP with armed with the right questions and the
exactly,
right response.
One of the other issues after childbirth is tears, and quite often a woman may have an episiotomy or a tear involving the vaginal opening or sometimes the labia, and they're unhappy with how it looks mm-hmm. and how it feels. And again, that's a lot of women come to see me to request corrective surgery to try and restore yes. their anatomy back to the way it was before.
Yeah. And I'm guessing throughout all of these treatments, you have some amazing stories of how you've helped women. You know, just given the topic and how reluctant women are to talk about it,
yeah.
can you share any kind of examples of how some of the treatments you've done have completely transformed
yeah.
someone's life?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I'm always fascinated by the stories that women tell me when they come back in terms of, because we're obviously concerned with how their function has improved and how the surgery's gone, but it's how it affects their day-to-day life.
Mm-hmm.
And I had a woman a couple of years ago came back, and she'd slept in the same bed as her husband for 12 years. So she had incontinence and she wet the bed.
Uh-huh.
And she'd been sleeping in a separate, none of her family knew, nobody knew, but they, for over 10 years they'd been sleeping in separate beds, and she mm-hmm. had an incontinence treatment done and was dry, you know, when she came back.
That's
so
amazing.
So
and another, quite emotional here.
Yeah,
that.
Yeah. Another woman recently, and I said, "Oh, how did she get on?" She said, "Oh, it's great, you know, if incontinence is gone." And I went out and I bought a fabric sofa. And I
wow.
was like, "Oh, sorry, I don't understand." And she'd always bought like a vinyl sofa because she wet herself on the sofa.
Yeah.
So it was easier to wipe down a vinyl yeah. than fabric. Other women who maybe never use public transport.
Yeah.
You know, because they're worried about getting caught, so we use taxis, saving, and now able to use buses again.
Yeah.
So those are like little things
really
like that are
yeah.
basic things. But in terms of intimacy, you know, that's another you know
yeah.
really really interesting area. And when they come back, and talk about the changes there, but it's I suppose I like to share those stories with patients because it is such a sensitive area. People don't talk openly
mm-hmm.
about it, so I try and gather reviews from patients. So those are on my website,
yes.
and they're also on my Instagram, and also I have a profile on a website called Real Self, and that's more for cosmetic procedures like labiaplasty and vaginoplasty,
yeah.
and they'll talk then freely about their experience and how it's changed their life.
Yes, because I get so powerful to hear testimonies like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, no, definitely, yeah.
And I suppose, you know, I ask most of the doctors that we talk to on here, you know, what kind of key improvements or lifestyle changes would you encourage women to introduce into their lives if they haven't already, just to promote good urinary and gynae health?
Yeah, so good diet, plenty of exercise, avoid obesity.
Okay.
Pelvic floor exercises.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's probably, everyone knows that,
yeah.
you know, but... You know, and it's not just, you know, sometimes it's, you know, when someone comes with a really embarrassing problem and they want it fixed, you know, they don't want to hear me say, you know, go away and lose some weight and do your pelvic floor exercises. You know, they want a treatment. But what I would always try and put across is, like, I'm more than happy to do your surgery or give you your treatments. But if you do these other things yourself, that
yes.
will maximize the success. So, for example, if I was to do an operation for stress incontinence, in someone who was of normal weight and healthy lifestyle,
mm-hmm.
there may be like a 90% success rate. But if you come to me and you maybe haven't done your pelvic floor exercises and you're overweight, then I'm going to drop that success
yes.
down to maybe 60-70%. So it's about optimizing
yeah.
for the bigger treatments.
Yeah.
yeah.
So the better
yeah.
shape you're in to start with.
Before
and
surgery,
then,
yeah, yeah.
And
yeah.
obviously
and
it's, yeah, and
yeah,
it's about
yeah,
being
yeah.
proactive in terms of managing it yourself.
Yeah, exactly.
And you mentioned pelvic floor. In fact, you've mentioned it quite a lot throughout the podcast. And I suppose it just occurred to me there, you know, what do you mean by pelvic floor? And particularly, how do we re-engage it? You know, is there anything we could be doing while we're standing in all of these queues that we're standing
yeah.
in at the moment?
No, that's a really good question, Avril. I teach a lot of medical students and junior doctors, and I'll often ask them, what is the pelvic floor? Or how would you explain it to a patient? And there's often blank expressions. So if you're a woman listening to this and you don't know what your pelvic floor is, don't be ashamed or embarrassed. Most people don't know.
Uh-huh.
The way I typically describe it to people is if you imagine a trampoline and the outer support structure of the trampoline is your pelvis, the pelvic bones, and the bit in the middle that you jump on that's the pelvic floor. So those are the muscles that hold everything up. And within the pelvic floor in a woman, there are three holes. The one at the front is to pass urine through. Mm-hmm. The one in the middle is the vagina. And the one at the back is your bowel. Mm-hmm. So if you imagine the trampoline is kind of surrounding those three holes, or those, if those muscles are nice and strong, that will help to maintain continence. Mm-hmm. But if those muscles are stretched and weakened, then you may have urinary incontinence, you may have vaginal laxity or prolapse, or you may have bowel dysfunction. Yeah. So having those muscles strengthened is really important. In terms of how do you contract your pelvic floor, mm-hmm. there's a girl who does a lot of stand-up comedy, and in Edinburgh actually, she's a physio there, and she recently did some research to see what was the best way, what was the best analogy to use, and mm-hmm. it's basically telling someone to hold their wind. So basically, if they feel like they're going to pass wind, the muscles that you would squeeze to stop that.
Okay, we're all going to rise in the floor.
that's proven with research.
Okay.
So they've been able to basically show that's the one thing that everyone knows what that is. So that's engaging your pelvic floor. So it is really important that women do it properly. A lot of women do it the wrong way and they push down instead of lifting up. So that's why, seeing a physiotherapist to help make sure that you're doing it right is really important. There's also an NHS app called Squeezy app, which you can download, and it can also give advice and reminders and things.
So you could be kind of activating these muscles then, and you should be. Are you telling us that throughout the day?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah,
that's really useful. Well, something to get us all thinking. Thank you so much, Dr. Patrick Campbell. I have learned so much today. Feel very much more educated on the issues, and thank you to everyone who's listening, and particularly those of you who sent questions in. This and all of our podcasts are available over on all of the podcast channels. You'll also find Kingsbridge Private Hospital on social media, and you can follow us on there. Thank you so much for listening, and we'll see you next time.